Hey, it's Liz D'Alto, and this is the Untamed the Wild Soul Woman podcast. From body image, sex, spirituality, money and relationships, to motherhood, creativity, business, communication, and desire, Untamed the Wild Soul Woman is the place to come for real stories and powerful advice to help you reclaim and redefine womanhood in the 21st century.
What's up, wild ones? It's episode number 155 of the Untamed the Wild Soul podcast. I am your host, Elizabeth D'Alto, and today's guest is Satyen Raja. Put simply, this episode is about high quality showing up. Satyen is a relationship expert, leader of leaders, an adoring husband and father. And we touch on each of these roles in this interview, and I invited him to take us the deepest around relationships and personal integrity. We talk about earning things from the school of life, true leadership, the relationship between action and wisdom, short-term thrills versus long-term aliveness, sexuality as a divine aspect and the deepest terrain of devotion, and shifting from a remedy mindset to an evolutionary mindset. And for those who are just as interested in feminine and masculine energetics as I am, you're really going to dig his description of the feminine and masculine triads. This will be one you want to listen to more than once and invite your loved ones to join you for. I can't wait to hear what you think. Come on over into the Facebook group once you listen and let us know your reflections, insights, and questions. It's untameyourself.com/Facebook to get over there. You're also welcome to check out the show notes for any links or anything that we mentioned at untameyourself.com/episode-155. Let's get going with Satyen Raja.
You all already heard me introduce Satyen Raja. And Satyen, are you ready for the first question? All the men get?
Yeah, let's go for it.
What do you love about being a man?
Well, I love that I get to be with my woman. And being a man, I can enjoy my lady, Suzanne, my wife of 29 years, in a very profound and juicy and rich and sensual and sexual and heart way. So being a man in that context, you know, it doesn't really mean anything unless I have a juxtaposition to enjoy that with, you know. So my beloved is that. That allows me to enjoy the manliness inside of myself, you know.
Oh, that's cool. And how would you describe your particular flavor, interpretation, expression of manliness right now? Because I'm sure it's evolved over time, but what is that? How would you describe it at this point in your life?
For me, it means that I have something that I'm claiming about myself, claiming in my world, claiming in my purpose, claiming in my direction, and the capacity and the willingness and the discipline to execute and to bring it into reality. So for me, being a man also means being honest with myself, with my shadows, with my light, but not hanging out way too long in the shadow healing side, because that could go on 20, 30, 40 years. But really, you know, what am I about? What's, you know, here's what it is in a nutshell for me. I ask this question of myself daily. It's what must I do to live today, to love, and to die completely, really, without regret, you know, without any backstory, without any regret. And so when I ask, what must I do today to live, love, and die completely, something's going to arise in myself. And when I follow it, and when I align myself and do that action that emerges from within, then I'm fulfilling my purpose. And that to me makes me feel very whole and complete, even if it's challenging. But if I'm not doing that, then I feel I'm eroding and not utilizing the innate capacities I've cultivated, right?
It's so great. It's so great. And so, yes, speaking of innate capacities you've cultivated, you used two words there. You said willingness and discipline. How did you cultivate willingness and how did you cultivate discipline? And I know this is part of what you teach, so feel free to put it in a context of what you do and how you teach or whatever, but I love the origin stories of like how people got to be the magnificent human they are now.
Well, you know, in this warrior sage philosophy that I aim to live by, the principles are there's willingness and then there's capacity. So some of us have high willingness, you know, when you're new at something, you know, full of piss and vinegar, and it's like, yeah, I can do that, no problem. I'm willing to do that and jump on that and make it happen. But you may have less capacity, right? Because you haven't earned it from life as yet and from the school of life. Or we can be down the other end where we have a lot of capacity that we've gained from life experience, from tracking earth, you know, by living on the ground. And we've got a lot of capacities, but sometimes folks with high capacities, they have less willingness because they've been doing it for a while. So what I like to sense in myself is if my willingness is high or is my capacity high? Usually someone who's more practiced, more seasoned down the road, their capacity is high and their willingness is lower. People who are usually new on the path of cultivating or growing something or have high willingness but less capacity. So I feel that we got to have both. And that willingness is the discipline to whatever emerges from yourself, taking the steps to make it happen and doing it with realness and without fanfare. Here's the other thing, without fanfare.
Yes. Say what you mean by that. I think I know what you mean, but I want to hear it.
Well, you know, we've been on Facebook, right? So, you know, the whole idea of, you know, people declaring their goals and their dreams and their wounds and their and what they're going after and all that. What I've discovered is that there's a balancing force that happens that always topples us, topples myself, topples everyone who are expressing too much about what their goals are, what their intentions are. They're making a fanfare of their pain, a fanfare of their healing. They're making a show, really, out of their growth, which I see there's reasons why, but most of the stuff out there doesn't really work, I've seen, in terms of what it takes to grow followings and grow all of this. It's all designed. It's all a game, a sham. It's all designed to create self-importance. Even woundology, even expressing my vulnerability, even going... there's a tactic inside, and that's to gain more followers, more trust, more love, more connection from my audience, all of that. Anytime it's a tactic, anytime it's strategic, even at an intentional level, then it's not authentic. Mm-hmm. It's not real. It's feigned authenticity. It's drummed up, and it always has a balancing force. So for me, it's better to be in silent power, cultivate what you really are good at, and do it. And then the power that's gained from doing that, the feedback you get from your clients, your team, everyone, they're then it's real. It's not full of shit and full of sparkle.
I love it so much because, you know, and I think most people can spot it a mile away, can feel.
No, they can't.
All right. Well, I can spot it a mile away.
Only really awake people can.
All right.
Most people fall hook, line, and sinker for the bleeding heart and bleeding eyes and crying, and they get the sympathy vote. But the people are putting that out there. They're looking to sell their product and service from the sympathy vote or the vulnerability from the vulnerability angle. And then guess what happens? It backfires because those people who are really into that and feel, look at them, so they're so vulnerable. They're the ones that don't actually buy anything or sign up or move anything forward, but they will be your greatest followers and will.
I'm laughing because like I know so many people, even some people that have been very close to me in my life who that's what's happening. I'm always noticing is what you're sharing inspiring people to take action or inspiring people to commiserate with you, right? Okay, so the people watching and listening, there's two angles that people might be coming at this from. Some people might be those who are trying to build a following, wanting to build a business, a brand, or whatever, and they're hearing what we're saying, and they're going, okay, cool, note to self, do this or don't do that. And other people might be the consumers, and they might be going, oh, huh, now I'm having more awareness just by listening to the conversation about, you know, who's authentic and who's not. And that's a buzzword. I'm looking at my calendar. I believe Philip, by the time your interview comes out, Philip McKernan's interview has already come out. And we talked about this. We talked about vulnerability. We talked about authenticity. They're such buzzwords. And it's one of those things where, are you into stand-up comedy at all?
Yeah, I love stand-up comedy.
So Dave Chappelle is one of my favorite comedians, and when he had his Chappelle show, one of the skits was called When Keeping It Real Goes Wrong. I like to sometimes say When Keeping It Spiritual Goes Wrong, because I see a lot of it.
Yeah, I'm with you. I understand.
Cool. So you said this thing that I want to dive into a little bit more because it's compelling, and it's sexy in a way that's like the way truth is sexy. Silent power. It's less about talking about the thing. It's more about being the thing. So how do people in your warrior sage worlds cultivate the silent power?
Well, one of the ways is stop telling everyone your affirmations and your goals. And although, you know, there is some forms of school that say, you know, tell people your goals and shares and all of that. The warrior sage way, what we do is we cultivate this crucible of being within ourselves. We find out what's really true for us by asking us this question: what must I do today to love, live, and die completely? Like, for real. And then when asking that, whatever arises, hold that as a sacred key, a sacrament, really, an offering from within your own soul, and then act on it. But no one needs to know. Mm-hmm. You know, we've got it set up so even our charities, you know, like you get a reduction in your taxes when you fill out a, you know, what if we just gave silently? What if we did our acts of power in silence, with all anonymously, without even a receipt to lower our taxes? Then the true energy of silent power, if you can get the vibe of this, not telling everyone where you're going next and where you're going next and where you're going next. You know, it's nice to see on the internet people going here and here and here. And who do they attract? They attract people who are wanting to be traveling and going and having this type of luxury-free lifestyle. So if you're selling a luxury-free lifestyle to people who don't have it, then showing these things is eliciting and evoking of their, wow, I want to have that one day. That's great. But silent power is keeping it to yourself. When you do that, there's a deeper power that happens that comes across through the sound of your voice, not through the visuals of your background, that comes through the sound of your being, the expression of your being, the truth of who you are. It's felt. And those who appreciate that, those who have the discernment and the sensitivity to appreciate and feel depth of being, that's where the true value is nowadays, I believe. The value's moved away and is moving away from bling, bling, fast, fast, how cool you are, how hot you are, how socially savvy you are, even your articulation capacity. All of that is, in my belief, falling away, and what's being left is what's real. And those people who are real in their silent power will be here 5 years, 10 years, 20 years.
Yeah.
Whereas those who are flash in the pan are going to come and go. We have to decide who we are. Where do we want to be? Do we want to be the vision of love and freedom, or do we want to be the truth of love and freedom?
Yeah, it's so good. And for the people who want to be the truth, the resonance with the silent power, I think this is the fear, right, of people who feel like they need to talk about it, self-proclaim, do the self-importance game and all that stuff is like, but if I don't tell anyone, how will they know? And that's exactly the thing. If you're doing your work, people will know. You don't have to tell anyone. They will just feel it. People will be magnetized for you by what you are and how you show up and who you be, not necessarily by like what you're saying.
You know, silent power is summed up in what one of my friends shared with me in a sacred ceremony in Peru. We were deep in the jungle and we were deep in a sacred ceremony, and we were coming out of it. It was the end of the night, and my friend said something that really touched me deeply. It was, may the words we speak be deeper than the silence we break. And the cultivation to come to that, to be aware of that, to want to come from that place even, that's, I feel, for me, is the path of the warrior sage. It's the warrior sage. The warrior is the action. The sage is the wisdom holding the crucible of wisdom, of lightness of being, of joy, of humility, of transcendence. And the warrior is the one that acts in spite of fear. The warrior is the one that is grounded in themselves. They're not being pushed around by other people's choices and desires. Combined, we have a very powerful archetypal spark when we enliven both these qualities within us, you know?
Yeah. So I had shared a post of yours. I didn't really get all up in the Standing Rock conversation. And one of the reasons is one of my discernments is if I haven't done research, if I don't know what's going on, and honestly, if I'm not super passionate about something, and it's not to say all these causes aren't really worthwhile, but if something's not super tugging on my heartstrings, I'm not going to go all in on something just because everyone else is, you know? But you had written the only post about Standing Rock that I actually shared, which was like, hey, you guys, if we're going to the front lines is cool, but warrior sages, and this is just such a great example of what you just shared about, like, there's action, but it's combined with wisdom. And you talked about the type of action that, like, would have the wisdom packed into it. Do you remember that post? I'm sure you do.
I remember the essence of it, yes.
And what
it's called a strike at the source.
Yes. And even that, right? Like, so many people are chipping away at, like, the external looking things, or, like, for example, going to the front lines before considering what kind of impact does that really have. And to my understanding of your post, you were being like, yo, here's the impact. Like, go protest in front of the people's houses, like, make the people uncomfortable, hit them where it hurts. This is how you'll actually create some change. And I loved that because it brought the wisdom to the action. I think lots of times there's so many messages and teachers out there going, take big, massive action, stand up for things. Great, that's important. And, but is it just making a difference, or is it just creating more noise?
Well, you know, the saying massive action creates massive results. There's truth in it, but it also creates massive headaches, massive strokes, massive relationship problems, massive time away from your family. It also creates a lot of massive other things. So for me, you know, when we talked about the Standing Rock thing, the principle here from the warrior sage perspective is we can all run to the front lines, the end of there, of the, and we can use this pipeline as a metaphor for anything that we want to create change in. You know, I had people call me up, hey, you want to go? Let's gather, let's pack up and go to the front line. Well, there's a self-importance there. There's a rallying energy, and it's fun and exciting. There is a rallying energy to be there. But if you actually want to stop that, you've got to find out who owns it. Where are they? Where do they live? Go talk to them. Go find out where they live. Find out. Go to the root. Stop the money flow. Don't purchase. How much? I'm just wondering how much oil and gas was spent for everyone getting on the front lines of Standing Rock.
There you go.
We got to make the change. You know, I did it. I had a little car accident. Nothing injurious or anything. It just, the way it got hit, I had to write off the car, which I had for about a decade. And I decided this about a year and a half later, I haven't bought another car. Now I could buy a Lamborghini, I could buy a Ferrari, I could buy whatever car I want. Doesn't matter to me. But I felt, can I cultivate silent power? I already got two other cars on the property. Can I feel, how can I move around in a world being financially, you know, free to buy what car I want? Can I calm that immediate desire and settle into myself? And you know what? It's amazing. I don't even care now. It's like, I don't need a car. There's three cars in my property, like family car, two other family cars. What am I? More and more and more and more and more. That's how I'm going to shift the oil situation by myself personally, by using less.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
That's silent power and real power.
Yeah. And also, I think part of that comes from, Lao Tzu says something similar, but I love to quote Bruce Lee, like, it's not about the daily increase, it's about the daily decrease and about hacking away at the unessential. Into that, I just ran a training at the time of recording this called Unconsume Yourself. As a culture, we're so consumed. And it sounds like what you're advocating. I mean, we're consumed materially, emotionally, financially, all these things. And it sounds like one of the things you're talking about as well is, you use the term, I just wrote it down, settling into myself. And more is not always better. Can you jam on that?
So in this worst age philosophy, the purpose of money is to purchase life experiences. Really, that's it. There's nothing more complicated than that. Right? So we can choose to have stuff, or we can choose to have life experiences. When we know what we want with our money, we're more likely to get that than just by going after an X amount of arbitrary number, 1 million, 2 million, 5, 10 million, whatever the number is in one's mind to feel wealthy. For me, consumerism comes from the idea that things will give you what you want. They don't. They bring you an experience. So I'm always, always going for what are the experiences I wish to have and create. Travel, time with my family, whatever that is. You know, I like studying with mentors and coaches. You know, I have a handful myself, from martial arts to many, you know, mostly martial art coaches I've had through many years. And that's what I love to spend my money on, and great food and excellent food, things that bring me long-term aliveness and bring my family long-term aliveness. And so it was a journey for me to reorient around short-term thrill to long-term aliveness. And that's this path of the warrior sage, which is about being here when everything else falls away. There's just you always shining in the light at the end of the day.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's what it's about.
I also like the way that you have reframed. There's a phrase we hear all the time, short-term pain, long-term gain, things like that. But I like how you've phrased it as short-term thrill versus long-term aliveness. I love looking at like living fully. What does that mean to everyone? And I know one of the things, two aspects of the different types of work that you do. One is relationship, sexuality. One is leadership. So which thread do you want to pull first? Because I want to go down both.
Let's go down sex. That's always great to talk about.
Yeah, let's do it. It's the Untame the Wild Soul podcast. Everything goes.
What do you want to ask? What do you want to dive into?
All right. So in our culture, I think sex is getting less and less taboo. It's always interesting to me to notice what's coming into the mainstream in a way it wasn't before. And I think with the dawning of 50 Shades of Grey in the last few years, okay, people are maybe becoming a little more open-minded to things, but the energy around it is still not super clean. So that's kind of the thread I want to pull. How people relate to their sexual desires and their pursuits and their interactions with other people from like a clean place, not, again, to relate to what we were saying earlier, not just like a consumption place.
I understand. Well, you know, the way the warrior sage accepts sexuality is it's a divine aspect of our nature. Obviously, there's the procreative aspect, but then there's the creative aspect, which we've all heard of in some way or another. This is not new to probably everyone listening here. But how do we, you know, sex should be something that's celebrated. To me, sex is the, with my beloved, is the deepest, terrain of devotion.
Mm.
Right? For Suzanne and I, relationship is a sacred devotion. So that's the essence of the path of the warrior sage in relationship, is it's a path of devotion. Can I serve my beloved? How can I offer and give of my beloved to fulfill who they are? Help them attain the highest, the most pleasure, the deepest heart, the wildest dreams. So I'm in there to serve, and vice versa. My beloved is there to serve. So we go out of our way to make it exciting, juicy, playing the edge, keeping it alive, fostering our passion. For us, it's the first thing. If I wasn't in a committed relationship, I'd probably be serving the world in a different way, right? But because I have a beloved, you know, Suzanne, and it's like, well, 2017 will be 30 years for us. Unbelievable. It feels like just a few weeks. This type of long-term, passionate, fulfilling relationship, the essence of it is devotion. Mm-hmm. It's devotion to each other and devotion to unlocking and opening the divinity and the divine path within each other. Who knows even how? You may not even be skilled. It's just the altruistic teenage adult devotion to that. That's all that counts. The how-to will fall out of the devotion.
Yeah. So great. I love being able to speak with someone who's been in a committed, passionate, juicy, all the words you used, relationship for 30 years. Because I think also, and I've heard, do you know Esther Perel?
Yes, I know her. Yes.
Cool. Haven't had her on the show yet, but she'll be on eventually. But I listened to an amazing podcast with her probably over a year ago, how our consumer culture has gotten translated onto relationships because people kind of have this like Amazon Prime mindset about everything. Well, if this doesn't work, I'll just order up a new one. Like there's always more where that came from. Instead of doubling down on what you already have and being willing to like go in and do the work to get through some tough stuff. So I'm curious, still keeping the topic on sex. Using sex as a means of working through the tough stuff in relationship, because I've experienced it as both a connective thing, but also as like a bypass thing. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
What are your opinions on that? Or just what's your advice on that? Anything you want to say there?
Well, you know, really, I'll give you the essence of our sexuality teachings, the essence, the core.
Cool.
We have these energetics within us, masculine and feminine. I'm sure you've heard of that. Many of us have. We all have it, whether we're male or female, whether we're, no matter what our sexual style or preferences or orientations, we all have these energetics in us. The Hindus call it the Shiva energy and the Shakti energy, life force and consciousness. Witness consciousness is the Shiva. They call masculine, although I don't think that's a great translation, which because it stirs up maleness, which is not what I'm talking about. And the feminine essence is very connected to female, obviously, but there's far more to it than that. But there's these energetics and these dials. For the masculine, for me to really serve my goddess deeply, I have to offer her three things as a triad. And it's presence, meaning I'm there. I'm not distracted when I'm there. Even if it's a short time, I'm fully there. My heart is there. I'm like attentive and wanting to know what's in front of me, what's going on with my lover. I'm present, a genuine interest without distraction. Okay, that's presence. The other one is a sense of claim. I'm with you, beloved. We're by each other. I'm with you. I'm not going anywhere. I claim you not as mine in the bravado sense. It's claim of I'm. You know what? I'm sick and tired of just floundering. I claim us together. We're going that way. So that's claim. Very sexy. And then the last piece is penetration, which is feeling I'm already inside my beloved. I'm not trying to pull her pants off or rip her clothes. I'm already breathing her. I'm already in her soul. I'm already feeling what's it like to live in her heart. So presence, claim, and penetration. What do? Well, they evoke the reciprocal energy, which is the feminine triad. So presence evokes invitation. And invitation is, beloved, I love you. Come closer. Come see me. You know, seduction, invitation, a sense of homecoming, a sense of welcome. So invitation, that's followed by surrender. And surrender is, you know, surrender is the reciprocal of claim. If you ever wondered why you can't surrender enough, it's because your partner's not claiming you enough.
Mm-hmm.
If you ever wondered how do you get your partner to surrender more, then you got to claim. So they feel there's a strong place to surrender into. These are male-female dynamics. Anyone can play these. But surrender is that feeling of, take me deeper than I could go myself. Totally. Playfully, from your power. And then the last element of that, so there's invitation, surrender, and the last part is expression. So penetration, entering, evokes deeper expression. If I'm pensive and I'm pulled back, that's not going to want to make you want to be expressive. It's going to want to make you pull back.
Yeah.
So when these three are working together, presence, claim, and penetration are working together with invitation, surrender, and expression, oh my goodness, you've got this. It's like an electric, heart-connected, evolutionary, passionate relationship.
Yeah.
But we have to be the ones that cultivate and are aware of those dynamics. So if there's one that's faltering or we haven't tended to, okay, I haven't tended to presence with my beloved today. Let me give her some presence. Oh, she may say, well, you know what? I haven't shown him any invitations. Been working hard all day. Here I am talking about this and this. How about if I show him some more invitation? Yeah. Have him come closer, hug him. So these dynamics are a co-devotional offering.
Ah, those are like some of my favorite words I've ever heard put together before. Co-devotional offering. Yes, keep going.
That's the heart of it. It's a co-devotional offering to one another. If you're not in a relationship and you're not willing to give those, you're only willing to receive partial or a few of those, then get strong enough psychologically, get healed enough psychologically, get well enough, get whole enough so that you feel good enough to offer those.
Totally.
You know, because you're only going to, and if you already are in a relationship, then can I offer presence, claim, penetration, invitation, surrender, expression? Can I offer those with more vigor, with more tenderness, more sensitivity, more wildness?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. So here's what I'm wondering now. It seems to me like this presents, it sounds awesome. I'm with you. I'm following. And I'm also seeing from my own experiences that I'm totally projecting into this conversation right now, a chicken and an egg situation, right? Because I've certainly been there when I'm like, well, if this mofo would just be more present, I'd be happy to surrender. You know what I mean? So
everyone is going to fail.
Yeah. Yeah.
Even God's going to fail you.
Yeah. So how do we...
Everything's going to fail you. Everything's going to fail you.
Yeah.
My penis one day is going to not work. I'm going to have to slap it and inject it. You're going to probably have to roll your boobs up to get them into the bra one day. Like everything's going to fail, right?
Yeah.
So it's not that if you're waiting for who's going to go first,
yep,
that's the perpetuation of suffering.
Yes.
Suffering is perpetuated by the waiting for it to come first. Mm-hmm. I say you got to give it, cultivate it, give it, even when it's hard.
Yeah.
And if you've got a partner who's willing to play with you and give back, great. If they're not, it's way over their head. They're not interested in an evolutionary relationship and you are, get the fuck out.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. If you are interested in having a relationship, which you're evolving with and that you're growing your soul, your body, your heart with, then by all means, then hold out for that.
Yeah.
And if you are in a relationship and you want to bring it higher and higher, then inspire your lover to go deeper with you.
Yeah.
Show them your desire to go deeper. You know,
totally.
There's no arrival. There's only, today's the only day. Suzanne and I have been together 30 days, but 30 years, but quite frankly, it's like today.
Yeah.
That's the only thing that really counts, right?
Yeah, so this is great. And I think it's a strong statement and it's confronting. And there's probably people listening going, oh shit, do I need to leave my relationship? And the fact is that maybe you do. Maybe you don't. Maybe there's a conversation. You know, this is why I have a courageous conversation framework so people can be like, hey, babe, let's listen to this podcast together and talk about this. It's one of the things I love about having a podcast. Instead of being like, so I'm speaking directly to those of you who are listening right now, look at your relationship going, okay, I've been doing the invitation thing and I'm not getting the presents, or I've been doing this, or maybe they've been doing that and I haven't been responding. Take this podcast and maybe listen to it together and go, cool, let's look at how we're both showing up. Don't go, you need to listen to this because you're not doing this shit. That's not going to be helpful. But bring in both people to the conversation. That's a good way to see if this is a place to stay.
One of the things to shift the mind from is remedy to evolution. Mm. To go from a remedy type of mindset. What can I do to remedy this? You know, in all the marketing that we hear of, you know, the first thing that we do is identify a problem and speak to the people's problem, right?
Right.
The challenge is that we're not always there.
Yep.
What if we drop speaking to all the problems and we speak to how we want to evolve together? Where do we want to evolve to? How do we wish to evolve and become? And then paint that picture in conversation and communication, artistically, drawing it out, chatting about it, making love while you're talking about it, whatever you, and then paint and create that, rather than because the continuously fixing things, there'll be no end to it. It's a neurotic wormhole that has no end.
Yeah. Yeah. So do you think, this is a two-part question and I can re-ask the second part, but do you think that people need to be at a certain point in their own evolution to even be receptive, to even hear the what's possible? And if they do, where is that? Because, you know, some people, like, I feel like some people can't even hear beyond their problems to even be excited about evolution. Does that make sense?
I understand. Well, this talk ain't for them.
You know what? Like, that's just straight up drop the mic. It's the truth. This isn't for you. Hashtag know your audience. Yeah. There you go. Answered the friggin' question right there. Thank you.
Quick break in the show to let you women know that you can officially start signing up as an early bird and save yourself $100 for our first four Wild Soul Movement weekend workshops of 2017. I will be running these myself April 22nd to 23rd in the Los Angeles area, May 27th to 28th in Vancouver, British Columbia, June 17th to 18th in Salt Lake City, Utah, and July 15th and 16th in Toronto, Ontario, Canada. Now, there will be more throughout the course of the year. Some of you will also get to meet some of my new, incredible Wild Soul Movement teacher trainees at these workshops. They're going to be so juicy, so exciting, so healing, and you get to gather with Wild Soul Women just like you. For those of you who have not yet experienced a live, in person, in real life, in the flesh, Wild Soul Movement experience, you are in for such a freaking treat. There is literally nothing like it on the planet. So head on over to wildsoulmovement.com/2017 workshops. Sign yourself up for whichever one or ones. You can come to more than one if you want to, that you want to make your way to. If you have any questions, you can reach out to us at hello@wildsoulmovement.com. And I literally cannot wait to meet you in real life sometime between April and July for those of you who choose to come. Back to the show.
All right, I want to pivot. I love that you're into martial arts. I feel like, especially for dudes, I remember a while ago I read a book called No More Mr. Nice Guy. I'm always so fascinated about learning about men because obviously men's brains, women's brains work so differently. And one of the things that book pointed out was how a lot of men in like our modern culture haven't really been indoctrinated into manhood. And it did say like martial arts is one of the ways that that really can happen. Could you speak to that? And what kind of martial arts do you do? How did you find your way into that? Like, I'm so curious.
Yeah, sure. Like you, I'm a Bruce Lee fan. Mm-hmm. I love Bruce Lee. I was a youngster and I saw Bruce Lee and also Kung Fu with David Carradine, a TV show back in the 70s. And I was blown open. I went, I want that. And so I sought out a Kung Fu master and I got into Kung Fu.
What was it that you wanted about it? I'm curious. Was it like you wanted to be able to like kick someone's ass or
For me, it was the spiritual element. Mm. I was a total geek. I mean, I'm talking non-athletic, no sports, anti-sport, not even a bookworm, just geek. And when I saw that, I felt home. Mm. I saw that there's a temple. And so I was really drawn to the philosophical, spiritual elements of this. And I was very blessed to find a Kung Fu master in school, a modern Shaolin temple, which they took me underneath their wing and helped me become really the man I am today. They gave me a strong foundation in service and love and enlightenment and all higher virtues. I was very blessed to have teachers of that caliber, you know, that ilk. And so I've continued. I've been studying since I've been about 12, so about 35 years now. And I've been involved in – right now my current training is Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, which for those of you who don't know, I think obviously everyone should learn it, women and men, because it's very effective. But Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu is like a whole-body human chess game that I'm addicted to, and I get to do with my son because he's 18 and really into it as well. So we have a nice father-son bonding experience. But it's a way of life. And I think martial arts, especially for those of us who have not had physical, mental, emotional, spiritual challenges, a choiceful challenge. There's challenges that come by you and you can take them and leave them and deal with them. And then there's choices you take on. A choicefully volitional challenge, you know, a volitional challenge.
Yeah.
As opposed to, oh shit, I'm challenged. That's not volitional. That happened to you.
Yeah.
That's circumstantial challenge. And then there's volitional challenge. We grow, the masculine within us grows through volitional challenge. Mm. And to me, it's the ultimate. It's the ultimate challenge. And Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu is nice because there's less philosophy. The philosophy is learned through doing the practice. You become humble because you lose 1,000 times in a row, you know?
Right. That's a good way to learn how to do something. Get your ass kicked, literally.
I'll give you the essence of what I learned in martial arts. It's my teacher said to me one day, he goes, Satyen, it's better to be humble all the time than to be humiliated all at once.
Oh, that's a good one. Yep. So I love what you said about the masculine grows through volitional challenge. And I also really appreciated your personal explanation of masculine and feminine energies earlier. That's actually one of our favorite things to geek out on the show. And your explanation was one of my favorite that we've heard. We've probably had dozens and dozens of people give us like their definition or their description of that. So I'm curious, in the various martial arts you've done, again, there are women who are needing to cultivate that strong masculine, that the light side of that, because everything has the shadow and the light, right?
They cultivate their strong feminine.
Yeah.
Are you kidding? The goddess can fucking rip things apart and tear them apart. And so martial arts, from the feminine dynamic of energy, is the protectress.
Cool.
Protecting of the self, protecting of the innocent. And so at first I used to think martial arts were more masculine, but where I'm at now, I think we're at an era now where it's for everyone. And, you know, quite frankly, whoever is smaller, you know, some bad guys don't go after the bigger looking, mean, tough people. They go after the people who look a little smaller, a little bit more demure, a little bit less challenging. So if we can cultivate that within ourselves, that also has a huge effect in our personal life or professional life, everything we do. But it could be beyond martial arts. It could be anything where you're actively involved in the body and you're challenging yourself, you're pushing your heart rate, you're going stronger than you can. And I think it's really good to have someone who can help you with that.
Yeah.
Guide, mentor, teacher to take you further than you can go yourself, you know?
Yeah.
That's what I
love this. I love this. And I'd be super curious for the warrior sage perspective on this. So I actually identify largely with that protectress energy. Part of my origin story, which people who listen to the show know this, I had no idea what feminine looked like, and I just thought I wasn't it because I wasn't prissy or girly. Until I got my hands on a book called Awakening Shakti by Sally Kempton, and I got to the Durga chapter. And I was like, oh, yeah, I've always been feminine. It just is fierce. It's like this, that protectress. Even now, right? Like, I have a community of women all over the world. And every once in a while, a woman will post something where someone has, like, done something to her. And it's not about being a victim. But, like, this happened recently where a woman shared a story where a man did something very manipulative. And my initial response was, I'm going to sit with this. I got to cool down, and I got to wait till the piece of me that wants to just drag this guy out to the curb and beat the shit out of him calms down, and I could actually share something useful with you. So I'm curious of your perspective on, like, I'm obsessed with how do we make things useful. So how does that protectress, how does that warrior, how does that, like, can tear shit apart? How do we make that useful for those of us who, like, have a lot of that? Selfish question, for sure.
That's a great question. Well, I think you're already doing it yourself. You're already doing it. Love has different flavors. Mm. Sometimes the flavor of love, and most of our identifications with the flavors of love, are soft, gentle, embracing, wholeness, tears, gentleness, acceptance, all these spectrums and flavors of love. The rarer expressions are the ones where our demonic and killing and ripping people apart. And but you know what? People have done that for love. How many soldiers in all the world wars have died so that their fellow citizens don't have to be, you know, worried about some conquering horde, right? So in the same way, in a small everyday way, this particular energy in India, once again, Durga, Kali is the feminine form of this ferocious feminine energy, but it's not ferocious because you're angry at someone because they've done something wrong, only to somebody. It's ferocious because it's outside. You feel it's breaking natural law.
Yes, yes.
That is holy ferociousness, sacred ferociousness. When you feel that there's sacred law that's being broken here, then rather than hold back, that expression, that invitation, and that's, you have to surrender to it, in fact, that energy, and allow it to come up. And it's wild. And quite frankly, people are scared of feminine power, especially when it's ferocious.
I have no idea what you're talking about. I've never had that reaction.
Well, shit, I'm scared of it when my wife is
kidding.
But I'm telling you, I'm scared of it. Yeah. And I'm a martial artist. I'm scared of it when my wife goes into it.
Yeah.
But we have to learn as men and women to embrace our fiery, ferocious side that is love, that says, what the fuck? What's going on there? Yeah. And sometimes we need to say what the fuck or fuck no.
Yeah.
And it's holding that ability to do so. Not, oh, no, no, no. Not pulling away or cowering, but facing with our eyes and the burning flame in our soul, our eyes and our tongue, and saying no.
Yeah.
We have to be able to do that when it arises. When we do, paradoxically, we're actually far more capable of being gentle, nonviolent, and centered in stillness.
I love this. And something actually, I remember someone explaining to me once about Kali, that now the context is sinking in a bit deeper after what you just shared, is that even though she's like the blood-tongued goddess with like the chain of skulls around her neck who can lop your head off, the lopping of the head off is actually much more gentle because it's swift and decisive than someone who's not embracing that energy and trying to pretend it's not happening and dragging out perhaps the suffering of it.
And then when she kills you, she makes an ornament out of you. She puts it around. A lot of little Satyen heads and all the guys you can think of, your assholes, all. And you wear a necklace of all the assholes you've ever met. You've torn them apart in the etheric realms.
And what's the benefit of that? Is there one?
Yes, it's divine enjoyment of our full spectrum. Really, at the end of the day, that's what it is.
I love it.
It's you are all of it, and we can be all of it.
Oh, it's so good. I think that's so important, because even if there's a part of the whole being shut down or denied, it's affecting the rest of the whole, even the parts we think we accept.
Exactly.
Man, it's good stuff. So Satyen, under the topic of untaming yourself, which really just means embracing what we just said, the full spectrum, all of you, the true you, is there anything I haven't asked you yet before we wrap up that you'd love to share?
Well, you wanted to speak about leadership, and I think
we're Thank you. Take me back. What's real leadership to you these days? Again, that's in that buzzword people talking about. What's to you, call bullshit on some of the stuff you see that's not actually leadership being portrayed as leadership these days.
Leadership to me is when given the opportunity to lead, you lead. Mm-hmm. That's it. I remember I was in my teens. I was at my kung fu school, my teacher's school. The head instructor was stuck in the snow somewhere, so couldn't teach the advanced class. And there was another instructor, more senior to me. And there was two classes going on at the same time. I was an apprentice. I'm not meant to teach. I'm just meant to warm up and do push-ups and all of that, right? Just learning. The master walks in and says, hey, the head instructor can't come in today. So the instructor there said, can you teach both classes at the same time? There's two classes at the same time, one upstairs, one downstairs at this martial arts school. And the instructor, far more seasoned than I, says, two classes, how am I supposed to do that, sir? Like, the master looked at him and he goes, you're dismissed. And he goes, yeah, you're dismissed. He goes, I'm sorry, sir, I'll come back tomorrow. He goes, no, you're done. Pack your stuff and leave. And I was like, holy shit. And he was crestfallen and walked away. Then he looked at me. I was just a teenager. And he goes, Mr. Raja, he goes, would you like to teach both those classes? And I go, yes, sir. And I fumbled through it. Yeah. I tried to figure out what to do upstairs and down. I made my way through it and I went, wow, I had some breakthroughs, because one class was way more advanced. But the lesson was, when given the opportunity to lead, you lead. And to be a great leader, you have to be a great follower. You have to be a master of both. And if you don't like the term, I'm a follower. I'm a follower. I'm a professional follower. Whenever I'm studying with my mentors, I'm there sweeping the doors, opening the doors, cleaning the toilets. I do whatever it takes to be a professional student. That's really my claim to fame, I feel. I love learning.
I love
which
that.
Then gives me which gives me the right to teach after a long time.
That is gangster, by the way. That's a master being like, okay, you're good. Dismissed. Right, because I feel like so many of us would be like, oh, I don't want to hurt that person's feelings. I don't want to discourage him or whatever. But the master was like, miss the opportunity. See you later.
Exactly.
Damn.
So I know that seems a little harsh, and maybe I wouldn't use that tactic nowadays. But the principle there is, in the wobble, there is an opportunity to lead. Mm. In the wobble is when we need to lead, not from confidence. It's in the wobble is the opportunity.
It's good. God, I love having a podcast. I love getting to, like, I'm, as you see throughout, I write things down so I remember, like, during the description and stuff like that. But some of it's just straight up for me. And this is one of those great conversations where I'm like, oh, I can't wait to go back and listen to this myself. So I know people can find you at warriorsage.com. I know you have so many different kinds of programs and stuff. So your interview is going to be up at like the middle to the end of February. Is there anything specific going on around then that you want to make sure we send people to?
Well, I have two main events that we're doing. One is Tantra, so the art of sacred evolutionary relationship. Mm-hmm. So I'm holding that. And that can be just – people just need to get on my warriorsage.com and get on our private email list there. And also we have our Accelerated Evolution Academy training, which is for helping professionals, anyone who helps others, therapists, coaches, guides, business leaders. I train the top of the top in the world to really become the most effective, profound, transformational artist, period.
Yeah.
Cool. So those are there, and you can find out about them there, and we have many different dates, so we'd love to see anyone who's inspired to come out.
Cool. Oh, thank you so much. Juicy, juicy conversation. I appreciate this and you so much. And I will also be reaching out to your wife because I got to get the other half of this equation on the show too.
Yeah, you have to meet her. She's an amazing mover and shaker, really powerful leader for some very powerful women in the world.
Cool. I can't wait. Thank you again so much. We'll talk to you later.
One thing that I do feel about this is that if we can enact change in the change makers and in the top elite kind of financial and governmental and political kind of people, there's so much change that can happen from enacting change in that group of people. And yet, of course, it's important to feed the homeless. And of course, it's important to do other, you know, things that tithing and things that I've just created a nonprofit called Rama Foundation. We're just launching it this week, actually, our first launch party. And so I it's very dear to my heart to bring wellness and meditation and peace to places that is not, they don't have the kind of luxury that we have. Right. And I also feel working with the change makers and working with the people who have the money and have certain levels of power is very, very important.